Absolutely. Mike, I thank you for the call. Your phone is just all over the place, so we're going to let you go. But on the subject of this health care bill that looks like it is absolutely going through 110%, we are in the darkest times of this thing. And like he said, they're going to tax you now for the federal health care. And if you don't want it, you're just going to be taxed anyway. Forget about 20 to 30% of your paycheck going to the government. Now it's 40 to 50% on a weakened dollar and on a system that New York Times, hard choice for a comfortable death. Drug-induced sleep near end of life common, but vexes family and doctors. So they're just coming out in the open and saying, yes, it's now common that we sedate and softly put euthanasia into place. Euthanasia. We euthanate people slowly. It's very nice to kill people. We don't say we're killing them. Euthanize. It's a nicer word. But the possibility that the process might speed death has some excerpts contending that the practice, in the words of one much-debated paper, a form of slow euthanasia, and the doctors who say otherwise are fooling themselves and their patients. They know damn well what they're doing. But again, this is a 10-page article to promote this. Do you remember Jack Kevorkian, Dr. Death? That type of thinking has now hit the mainline. It's a little worrisome. It should be. If you're a guy like me, if you're not part of the elite class, that 1% or 2% out there, even if you're in the upper echelons, if you're making 1 or 2 mil a year, 10 mil a year, yeah, you'll probably skate by on this. But what happens when your greedy little kid, who you didn't pay enough attention to and you didn't father, decides that at 68, daddy can be euthanized so I can take his empire? Didn't think of that one, did you? Maybe you should with your little selfish, it drives me nuts that this is even being promoted, that I had to see the case for killing Granny on the cover of Newsweek. It's disgusting. All right, let's continue with the calls. 888-201-2244. You can call 512-646-1776. Let's go to Mark in Oregon. Mark, you're on the line.
Hey, Jason.
Hey.
Jason, Feliz Navidad and the best, all the best to you and Alex and your loyal and faithful crew there.
Oh, thank you very much, sir.
You're welcome. Jason, I've got a couple of quick information bits about the state of Oregon, and okay. Then I'd like to give you what I think is the biggest story of the year.
You got it.
The caller that you have, your new listener out of Miami, he was talking about having to show everything right down to your passport, your birth certificate to get your driver's license.
Mm-hmm.
That's been going on here in Oregon for at least 5 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, in Texas, you've got to give your biometric thumbprint. I mean, Alex Jones put that in his film, America Destroyed by Design, in 1998. So, again, these guys are very, very patient. They implement these draconian rules on the state levels in different places where they can pass them. And then we just succumb to the tyranny. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, they just ease it on into you.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got a call from the Oregon Department of Health Services, which is basically the state health department. Oh, a couple of weeks ago in the evening, about 7 o'clock in the evening. And this young lady, she said she was doing a poll and she was going, and she kind of went through it really quick at the beginning of the call, who she was calling for. So I had to ask her again and then one more time to get the complete picture of who they're polling for, calling for, asking all these questions. And actually, they're calling on behalf of the CDC, acting through the Oregon Health Department.
Oh, lovely.
So the Centers for Disease Control wanted to know how is my daily state of mental health. They wanted me to give a self-evaluation. And there were one or two more questions. And then I just basically, and she also slipped in that if there were any children in the home that she could ascertain through the answers to the questions were not being treated up to snuff, that she was authorized and directed to contact the Child Protective Services.
Now, Mark, was this presented to you in a mandatory manner, like they call you up and say you have to participate in this?
No, but the tone of it was.
Mm-hmm.
The tone of it was.
Well, they love you to give yourself up. That's their big thing, you know. That's why an officer walks up to the car and just starts making stuff up. Oh, what'd you put in your side console over there? Sir, I don't know what you're talking about. Looks like you moved your hand a little, buddy. Why don't you step out of the car, put your hands on your head? All right, what do you think, Mark, is the biggest story in these final couple minutes of this segment of 2009?
I think the biggest story, Jason, you may not agree with me, but I think the biggest story is that you and Alex and the InfoWarrior crew and all of the InfoWarriors all the way around the world are still alive and kicking and just gone ahead with full head of steam, continuing to expose the evil of these bastards that are certainly intent on all of our demise here, and not in a good way. So I just want to thank you. I really want to thank you for all the effort and the energy that you have, do, and will put in to your efforts and all of our behalf, Jason, and God bless you, sir.
Well, thank you so much, Mark. And actually, this Christmas, I spent a little unorthodox. Obviously, the majority of my family is out in New York. And I have this aunt on my father's side. It's my only aunt on my father's side, really my only relations, her, my Uncle Charlie, and they have two children together. I don't know them that well. When I first came out here to Texas to do Fabled Enemies a couple years back, I did meet up with my cousin who goes to UT, but they're out in Houston. So I decided I'd met up with my aunt a few months back. I've maybe met her four or five times in my entire life. So I made my way out there to Houston for Christmas, and they were over at a friend's house, all this family around. And I really took the opportunity to talk to the man of the house, I guess. We were all sitting down, you know, eating, talking, and all this other stuff. We got into it big about politics. And luckily, you know, I had a couple copies of Fabled Enemies, a couple copies of Loose Change Final Cut, and a couple copies of Fall of the Republic with me, some of which I was going to give to my aunts and uncles. But I gave it to him and his brother instead. And this guy, well, let me just tell you about the conversation when we come back. It's the InfoWarrior, PrisonPlan.tv, InfoWars.com. This little Christmas story with a nice little bow on it. It's the Info Warrior with Jason Burmes. The end of the year, December 27th, 2009 edition. So I'm at this guy's home. Family's all around, buzzing. It's Christmas time. Very lovely home. Lovely family, the whole nine. The guy is pretty much a mainline Republican. He's calling himself a libertarian, but he's really still stuck in this left-right paradigm. And, you know, we start to discuss things and we get into Glenn Beck, for instance. And I'm like, well, you know, it's great that 75% of what Beck says is true, but the 25% that he's not telling you is really hurting you when he's demonizing 9/11 truth, when he refuses to talk about FEMA camps in a real way, the civilian inmate labor program, won't discuss it. We're kooks. And I explained to him that. And he said, well, you know, you've got to give him some credit. I'm like, no, I can't give him any credit. Because I was supposed to be on his show on the fifth anniversary of 9/11, and after I dominated the Popular Mechanics gentleman, who he brought on later for this FEMA special, I was canceled. They were promoted. And this was when he was at the big bad liberal network CNN, again, part of the media industrial complex. So then he brings up Sarah Palin to me, and I say, hey, Palin's saying some great things right now. Right now she's saying all the right things. But who is this woman? I said, it's somebody that they're propping up as a third-party usurper to ensure that Barack Obama makes his way into a second term in his presidency. This guy is an eight-year guy, folks. They like him. He speaks well. He is embraced by the international community. They're all about globalism. And I said, you notice she wasn't saying these things when she was McCain's running mate. And why else would they allow her, I said, to have a best-selling book on the New York Times bestseller list, all the media in the world, and leave the governorship of Alaska with no ridicule or concern whatsoever? I'm like, that's because she's their girl. And she will talk about the things we talk about it now, when it's safe. She still won't say, hey, it's time to get out of Afghanistan and Iraq. So mainline Republicans like that. And they may glom on to the fact that this is death care, because that's a talking point on Fox News. I said, do you see how you're being manipulated? We even talked about the prison industrial complex a little bit. You know, he was like, well, I don't understand why they still haven't decriminalized marijuana. And I said, well, it's a lot easier for them when they have people who are caught with a pound of marijuana or more, or a field of marijuana, to put them into a prison system for the next 1 to 10 years, depending on, you know, how severe it is. In some states, you're going to get a little worse than others. Usually like 1 to 3 or maybe 3 to 5, depending on what you've done. And you get to work for AT&T or Sprint or one of the other big corporations as a telemarketer for them for 39 cents an hour. I'm like, it works out great for them. They don't have to outsource the job to India. These people can still speak English. He's like, well, yeah, that does make sense. And we just went on and on and on and on. And really, I dedicated about 4 hours of my Christmas to waking this guy and his family up. And they were great people, very nice, lovely home, like I said. I can't thank them enough for having me for Christmas. Later on, we went to my aunt's house, and we all sat down, and we played some games, and it was really, really enjoyable. I actually found out that I was related to this Scottish artist named William McCants. They had an original McCants in their house, and they showed me these books on them. They had visited Scotland. It was really neat. But at the same time, this stuff sticks with me. It's part of my heart and soul. I understand that in order to defeat this system, in order for freedom and the Constitution and Bill of Rights to be reinstituted,